and make each other feel welcome. And then we'll sit back down and have announcements and enter the time of worship.
Love, according to Gloria, right? They love, love, love.
And that's sheep wool thing today.
Knitting.
So, I give enough of this for the life of the church and the community before I make any of that. So please look at your insert. Next week is even a more busy Sunday than normal. There are many layers of events going on. One is that Heather Pearson will be here to lead circle songs with another minister from Maine. So I'll be around, but they will be doing most of the worship leadership. Another layer is that it is Veterans Day weekend, and so we will be acknowledging veterans on Sunday. So we expect that to be the keys of our worship service. And also, because they are available, we are taking the opportunity to welcome to our church three people who are members of Trinity Church in Boston, one of whom is also actually Jackson resident, Janice Pryor. Many of you probably know her. She's an author and an artist. We posted her for Authors Magazine Pass. She is on a team at Trinity that has engaged in conversation and education and advocacy around racism. And in the wake of the wonderful conversations that we've had with our One Book, One Valley movement, we would like to continue to engage in meaningful conversations around topics that can be very sensitive or challenging. And so they will be with us all of Sunday morning. They're going to come to the 8 o'clock service that happens over at the little library now that it's cold. They'll be here for breakfast at 9 o'clock if anybody wants to come to a more intimate gathering and join in conversation about faith and race. And they will be here with us to worship, and then we will host a soup lunch afterwards and have an additional workshop with them. They'll be driving back to Massachusetts that day, so it's not going to be a long session, and it's only going to begin a conversation. But it helps us open up this conversation with people that have been doing it in their own church for several years. So we welcome them, and I hope that some of you will make time from your schedules to come either to a 9 o'clock breakfast or a pop-up lunch right after church and start to dig into this topic with us. So very rich and busy Sunday next week. Additionally, today, 3 o'clock, the Silver Lake Singers will be here, and they will be singing about healing of our environment and our own lives and our own communities. So please, if you have a chance, come back and hear them. They are a choir that sings usually for hospice. They only do choir or concert performances once or twice a year. They are all volunteers. They're led by Mary Eves. They've been singing here on Knopf and other places for the last few years, and they're a wonderful way for us to think about the honoring and remembrance of people in our lives and what we are called to do with our world. Just a mind aspect to the worship of the community. I don't think I forgot anything. And today is November, so I'll explain that shortly. Please take a moment to listen to the first piece of music that Sue will be offering for us today. What wondrous love is this? special music, and then she volunteered to do everything for us. Thank you so much. You're grateful for her gift. Our call to worship, as we have been doing it the past few weeks, involves both song and reading. So you will see that the refrain for taste and see leads into and ends our call to worship, and then we will read together as song, as the song is played underneath the words. So please, from where you're seated, begin taste and see.
Job fair today for a job, so prayers that if it's the right job for me, that I'll get it. It's at King Pride in Madison. And also prayer for Kitty from Kitty's Antiques in Fairmark. She only has one kidney, so she said sometimes it's tough with one kidney and it hasn't been feeling that great, so prayers that her one kidney will be stronger.
So prayers, first of all, that Kevin may find a job that is just the right fit for him, possibly at King Pine. And I know that he went early to that doctor because he wanted to drive all the way from King Pine to up here to be with us today. So, wow, impressive timing. And also for Kitty and her one kidney, be able to do what it needs to do for her body and that she will learn and grow.
Prayers for Gail and Eleanor Woodson, because Eleanor is in and out of the hospital and nobody knows what's wrong with her.
So prayers for Bill and Eleanor Woodson, and the answers to what may be happening in her life. Other prayers. We also ask, along with prayers of concern for what's happening on our hearts, for the things that make us joyful. And this week, we were especially moved by the prayer of Sue Davidson, whose daughter, or her, whose granddaughter, lives with cystic fibrosis. There is a new drug that has been released, which will address for about 80% of the population this illness, and has the possibility of changing it from a life-limiting condition to a different kind of condition. And her granddaughter is probably eligible for this treatment and should be getting it in a few weeks. And so prayers for the life of one young girl and all those who are affected with CF, that this revolution in treatment may lead to a change in life. And gratitude for the wisdom and insight of scientists and researchers and all those who had the courage to be part of the original trials to bring it to all the others who need it. Also gratitude for a beaver that was seen crossing the road with a tree. And for cheeky blue jays and chickadees. And for the wide openness of the world, now the leaves have fallen.
The animals at Tamworth Camping Area bring me a lot of joy, especially this pony called Puma. And their dog and cat, my boss's dog and cat at Tamworth Camping Area, Randy and Nico, always come up to me and it's nice. And the Thursday we had that storm. Before that, when I used to go outside in the yard at my landlord's house, caterpillars used to come up to me from front wide, I don't know why, and crawled on me. And one of them crawled on my sock and took a nap, curled up and took a nap on my sock.
So great gratitude for Brian, including a pony named Boomer, and caterpillars from far and wide taking
out of their toe. I'm very grateful for that storm that we had on Thursday, because if anybody knows, my driveway is very, very long, and it was completely covered with weeds, so we really couldn't see it. I had to know it, and there's trees on both sides. That storm, it, first of all, was a squash with the leaves whirling like that. I don't know if it's not a world for body. And it all landed on the grassy areas, and 90% of it, I had a driveway.
So prayers for the gratitude for the winds of the storm that cleared the driveway and made beauty with the leaves, but then put them on the side and made her
driveway out of the way.
That's how smart.
The other day, my daughter and I went outside to the front of my yard. And he all of a sudden went directly towards this little thing moving rapidly within the grass. So I went over and looked closely, and it was this absolutely soaking wet, little 3-inch chipmunk. So I panicked, rushed into the house because the cats were swirling. And I grabbed something, wrapped him up, picked him up, and looked at him and like, and his little arms and legs were so cold and my heart was beating and I looked at his little chest kind of rising slowly. So I took him into the house and I put him in a container with those tubs and I got my hair dryer and I start blowing him. And then I realized it's not work. joyful experience to see the way this little 3-inch chipmunk transformed into a ball, into a curl, into an uplifted face. And he was absolutely adorable. And so I covered him up for a while, and my heart was singing. I saved him. How many chipmunks are there in the world? And I felt so joyful. So my husband said, you need to let him go now. So I took him out in the woods. I got him in that rubber tub, and I had to look at him far away from my two cats. So I walked down the road carrying him, and then I put the little tub down, and boom, he's gone. And he races off, and then he turned and went, that's great.
I know this is how it was supposed to be.
Two ducks and a woodpecker on the same rock. And gratitude for the fleeting experience that was too fast for a camera, but is now part of your memory. Claire?
The last Christmas of the season, which was not changing color, the bright green with a little bit of gold, and was worried that it was getting way too cold, so I did bring it into my little chrysalis house. And lo and behold, it got nice and dark, which means it's getting ready to emerge. And I came home from babysitting, and Jim hadn't even noticed that the butterfly had emerged. But the problem now was, is it too cold out for this butterfly to be let?
Now, what do you do with a monarch on November 2nd?
It put him on a plane.
So keeping it inside was not an option, so on a sunny day I did put him out on the deck, and he hung around for a while, which they do, not there, so here's my fingers crossed, pound away.
So gratitude for the new life of a monarch in our changing season, and may it fly well.
my turkeys are back, I have to stop the practice. There was a flock of about 18, 20, and you better stop because they're not moving. They own the road. But it's nice to have them back, and they like the roost and crack out the trees.
All right, so for turkeys, 18 to 20 of them roosting in crab apple trees and stopping her on the road. Don't argue with the turkey.
No.
Yes, Judy. We have a little deer across the rock in front of it. I almost panicked, but I didn't hit him.
For a deer crossing the road. Let us be in prayer. O God of abundance, who is both shepherd and man in our lives, we give thanks for the amazing sightings of your creation, for all the ways that you come into our world, whether it is the wild wind, or the beaver, or the caterpillar and the butterfly, and all the other encounters we've had with you in the wild, and in our community, among our friends and our neighbors. Be with us and be present to us in this amazing and transformative way that you have of touching the world. Hear our prayers for those that we have lifted up, and for those that we have not named. church, the Chicago Church in the city of Wangtari, in the nation of Zimbabwe, and so many other parts of the world that are touched by violence and oppression and injustice, including our own nation. Be with those who are our leaders and those who serve. Listen now to our silence. And please hear us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, Sunday school out of this sanctuary. I would love to have the help of Gia and help. We're going to just pass out heart paper hearts to people. You will see that there are some branches that represent the tree of life over here. It's our tradition now during the month of November to remember those who have died. And so for the next few weeks, you are more than welcome to bring pictures or mementos of those that you love and place them near the tree of life. But today, please feel free to write on paper hearts, which, can you go grab them to Meg? She's gone away. And hopefully most people have pens. If we don't, I have a few pens. I will spend some pens with the girls as well. Maybe the heart people. And then a little bit later in the service, we will have to come forward and put those names on the tree. But meanwhile, we want to have you have those hearts so the girls will help you. Take as many as you need. Remember as many people as you want. And Sue will just play a little bit of music for us while they're just passing it out. Thank you. going to go ahead and be getting ready to watch the film Sunday School. So we are going to present to you a selection of scriptures. So Lori, if you would come forward. We're going to be reading brief passages from the Bible about shepherding and sheep. So we'll go back and forth between the images of the one who is the shepherd and the one who is the lamb.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Isaiah.
we didn't practice this. Alright, so, man's history. Genesis 22. Isaac said to his father, Abraham, father. And he said, here I am, my son. Isaac said, the fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together.
Isaiah 40, 10a through 11. See, the Lord God comes with might. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep.
From Exodus. Then Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, go, select lambs for your families and slaughter the Passover lamb. You shall observe this rite as a perpetual ordinance for you and your children. When you come to the land that the Lord has given you, as he has promised, you will keep this observance.
Ezekiel 34 through 31. You are my sheep, the sheep of my pasture, and I am your God. Says the Lord God.
From Isaiah 53. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth.
Matthew 18, 12. What do you think? If a shepherd has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountains and go in search of the one that went astray?
From John, the first chapter. The next day, John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.
John 10, 1 through 3, 3 through 4, 10 through 11, 11 through 16. Very truly, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father.
From the letter to Hebrews. Now may the God of peace who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus the great shepherd of the sheep by the blood of the eternal covenant, made you complete in everything, good so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. And finally, an image from Revelation. They will hunger no more, and thirst no more, and the sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat, for the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. And he will guide them to the springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. So end the readings. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. We know that we've been doing this series that talks about the elements of food in the Bible. And today's theme is the Lamb. And you can't talk about the image of the Lamb without talking about sacrifice. And I tell you that I struggled with this. I don't love the idea of the living sacrifice. And yet, if you have heard, it is inextricably woven into Hebrew scripture and into gospel and into the letters of Paul. And I want to share with you one other story. King David was a shepherd first. And he was mighty with his arm and his sling. And we know this because actually in ancient times, the Hebrew armies used left-handed rowers who were skilled with slings to throw missiles a great distance. And David was one of these. He could aim really well, and he used that sling to bring down Goliath. But first, he was a shepherd. And so, over time, King David rose to a position where he could have power over the lives of others. And he fell to the temptation of coveting another man's wife. And so, he sent his general to the front lines of the battle, knowing that he would be in harm's way and that he might die, in order that he could continue his relationship with Bathsheba. And by any account, this is a dishonorable act for an honorable man. And so, Nathan was sent to David to tell him the story and hold up a reflection of his actions. And so Nathan told him this story. There was a man in your kingdom, and he has one lamb, one ewe, a female sheep, who is as dear to him as his own daughter. He has loved and tended this one animal by feeding it from the food from his table, just like his children. It sleeps in his bed at night. It's kept warm and safe in his own home. This one ewe is everything to this man. But he has a neighbor who owns large flocks, a wealthy landowner who is having guests, but who did not want to put to death one of his own animals. And so he took the one lamb of the man who loved this ewe. And he killed that lamb and fed it to his guests. And David was outraged. He was a shepherd, and he knows the name of every sheep he ever tended. He knows the shape of their head and their characteristics and how they move and how each one is different and special and important. And he knows that when animals are lost or taken from their flock, that the entire flock can die from the shock of the loss of part of its own. And he said, this is a crime, and this man should be put to death for taking that lamb. And then Nathan said, the man is you. You took the life of another. But when you think about that one sheep, that sheep held within her body the entire well-being of the one who loved her. She could bear lambs. She could give milk. She could give wool. Generation after generation, she could provide him with what he needed to get by. There was a reason that he needed and loved that animal. And so when the neighbor took the life of the one animal, he took everything, not just the life of the animal, but all the future generations that she might have borne. The milk that she gave, the wool that she produced, everything that another person needed was taken in. In New England, in 1810 to 1840, we had about 600,000 sheep here. And we know that this has left an imprint on the land because that's about the time that the farmers built stone walls. 250,000 miles of stone walls built over a 30 to 40 year period when merino wool was so valuable that it could be exported and it was a valuable commodity for our area. And then the western lands were opened up for expansion and they didn't have rocks and they didn't have the difficult soil and weather, and so people began to move westward and they abandoned those farms. Sheep were no longer as valuable, so the walls no longer had meaning, but we find them still when we're out hiking the mountain. And now sheep are beginning to come back to New England, but not in the same numbers. But those sheep and that industry left its mark on our landscape. In England itself, there's a new kind of crime in rural areas where they actually steal 21 to 100 sheep at a time and then slaughter them on site and then sell them to illicit butchers. And indeed, the flocks that are left behind sometimes die in shock of the loss of the ones who have been taken. What does sacrifice look like in our lives? Christ was called the Lamb of God. And what does it mean to walk into danger? As he said, risking his life and willingly putting it down himself with the power to pick it up again. At 8 o'clock, we talked about what sacrifice might mean and how foreign it frequently is to our culture. What do we willingly give up? What would cause us to give something up? And how uncomfortable are we willing to be in order to make a change in the world? And when it came down to it, most people said that I might give something up at Lent, right, because that's a spiritual practice and we have that as part of our heritage. But what will prompt you? Your children. It is very likely that your children are one person or cause in your life that might inspire you to change something else so that this world will be different for those who have inherited. People that hid others during the Holocaust, abolitionists that helped slaves move north, and the slaves that have been freed that went back again to free others, and those that continue to talk about the injustice of what it means to be so easily arrested or in danger simply because of a brown body. People that give a kidney to another person because they have two and pay it forward. People who have no reason at all to make a difference but do because it's the right thing to do. Today when the Silver Lake singers come and sing to us, they will be reading the words of a young teenager who crossed the ocean to remind us that the world is in peril and that our children are asking us to wake up and pay attention because there is something that needs to be done and sacrifice to change the way things are going right now. Sometimes we will do for our children what we won't do for anyone else. And sometimes we are then the prophetic voice that call for change, where change is needed. And sometimes we have to be reminded by our children themselves that change must come. And change begins in us and in our communities. It doesn't have to be at big institutional places, although that's great. But we can do things right here and now that make a difference. What are your children telling you that worries them? What concerns them and moves them from being hopeful and resilient to feeling powerless and hopeless? Because sometimes that's what we're hearing. What are they saying needs our attention and our votes and our change of policy and action and choice? How are your children being prophets in your life? Okay, this is an act of courage, I'm just telling you right now, so I'm not a trumpet player. It's been working. We'll see if it works again today. This is a shofar. I have two examples of a shofar here. These are ram's horns that have been hollowed out. And in Hebrew tradition, when you hear them, God is present. And prophetic work is taking place. I learned to play a shofar this week. It has an embarrassing start, so just bear with me,
thank you.
each line, please stay with me together to remember that. In the rising of the sun and its going down. In the blowing of the wind and the chill of winter. Remember. In the opening of buds and in the rebirth of spring, we remember. In the blueness of the sky and in the warmth of summer,
we remember.
In the rustling of leaves and in the beauty of autumn,
we remember.
In the beginning of the year and when it ends,
we remember.
When we are weary and in need of strength,
we remember.
When we are lost and sick at heart, we remember. When we have decisions that are difficult to make,
we remember.
When we have joy we crave to share,
we remember.
When we have achievements that are based on theirs,
we remember.
For as long as we live, they too will live, for they are now a part of us, as we remember them. These branches will be up for the remainder of November through the Sunday before Thanksgiving. If you have anything that you want to put beneath those branches, or if there are new names that you want to add, you are welcome each week to share them. This is our time to remember and honor those that we love. Please rise for the song, 401 Amazing.
Thank you.
You are both lamb and shepherd. You have shown us what it means to walk into places of danger and risk everything to lay down your life and take it up again. Take our lives as an offering and make of us what you need in this world so that love and justice may go where they are needed. Bless what we have given you here today. Amen. Friends, we're going to begin communion. You may be seated. And again, because the friend's a little different today, we're speaking slightly differently, so you're going to come forward for a piece of bread, and if you choose your name, do a intention by dipping it into the goblet that will be offered. There will be a deacon at each end of the aisle to serve you if you so choose. Please join me in the Sursum Corda and Sanctus. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up your
spirits. Let us give thanks to God most high.
Give thanks to the grace.
It is very neat, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto you, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we love and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing together. Thank you. take of these, do so in remembrance of the one that washed the way of the lamb and the shepherd. If you wish to partake of communion, please come. Please join me in the thanksgiving that you can part in your bulletin. We are not alone. God made us.
We are not alone. We have each other.
Can anything separate us from the love of Christ?
Is there trouble, pain, or persecution?
No. In all these things, we win an overwhelming victory through the one whose love for us has been proven.
Thank you.
going to be